Mace Windu reporting for service, Master.
And I'm with you, bro.
Whoa, whoa, wait. All us Jedi have to call you Master, but he gets to use bro?
How I roll, that is.
Howdy we are.
I met them in a swamp down in Dagobah, where it babbles all the time like a giant carbonated soda. S-O-D-A soda. I saw the little runt sitting there on a log. I asked him his name, and in a raspy voice he said Yoda. Y-O-D-A Yoda. Yo-yo-yo-yo-yo.
So, JP.
Yeah, Ron?
Have you noticed how chubby George Lucas is with John Stewart?
How chubby?
Chubby. Oh. No, chummy.
Oh, chummy. Oh, chummy. Yeah. No, I thought it was bananas.
No, he seems like kind of a... Are they friends? Are they BFFs?
Here's a question. It's kind of like goes back to that Steve Jobs thing. You know, a lot of people think Steve Jobs only had, like, transactional experiences with other humans.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's like, I'm doing this for you, and you are doing this for me. That kind of stuff.
Really? Okay.
You know, like, yeah, kind of yeah, like, yeah. You know, yeah. that weird on-the-spectrum.
Right. No friendship. Yes. Just you scratch my back, I rub yours.
Right. And, yeah. And I think that there is a... I think there's a contingent of our listener base who believes that George Lucas is similar in that way.
Sure.
Maybe a lot of these moguls are.
I don't know. That video popped up on the internet recently where George Lucas is kind of in on one of John Stewart's little setups, and it's kind of Lucas talking about, you know, the liberal media and you know, like he did a
these
little
pink-owned bastards.
Yeah, like he did a little bit on The Daily Show, and it was like, oh, it came out of nowhere. I'm like, really? Like, and then I started to like kind of do a little bit of research, and it looks like anytime George Lucas had in the later years had like an announcement or something, he would kind of use John Stewart as kind of his voice box.
I mean, that seems accurate. Last time I remember seeing him on something that wasn't like an award thing or something, mm-hmm. is I think he was on C-SPAN, but this is in the Bush era.
Okay.
So that's all.
Well, we do know that Obi-Wan Kenobi's home planet is named after John Stewart.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah, that's right. Because
he was on the Daily Show, and John Stewart, being a Star Wars fan, apparently, is like, so what's Obi-Wan's home planet? And George Lucas, off the cuff, is like, Stewjohn, and that became canon.
Yep,
because it came from George's mouth.
Yep. Well, you know, that's what happens when you create an entire universe. You know,
those days are over.
George, is that still canon?
It's still canon, yeah. That is
well,
still canon.
I don't know if that's true. Because according to the press release, all that's canon is 6 films, the 2 cartoon shows.
And the Daily Show.
The new books. Oh, and the Daily Show.
But you got to read the little print.
It's an alt timeline, similar to, Jaina and Jason Solo.
I know we need to announce the show, but I just realized that...
We're doing a show?
Yeah, we're doing a show. Oh, this is a recording, JP.
Oh, wow.
I just realized that there was it went like back in the days of the EU and that, and there was G canon and C canon, and there was S canon.
Yeah, shit canon.
Yeah, that's what it basically stood for. Stupid canon.
Nice.
The holiday special was S canon. Basically just stupid shit.
Yeah, the abbreviated term for it should be shit canned.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
So speaking of shit canned... Who are we?
Oh, good lord. Okay, this is a podcast about Star Wars.
Star Wars? Yeah.
Called
Delusions of Granular.
And with me we have host Ron.
Ron.
And JP. They're going to break this down to be the slowest intro.
The slowest intro.
This is a slow since, jam. Welcome to SWU Dog Slow Jam.
The slowest intro since episode 6.
Oh.
When we used to take forever to do this stuff.
Yeah. I thought you meant like episode 6, like Return of the Jedi.
No.
And I was like, was that a particularly long crawl? I thought you were like doing granular.
We used to take forever to get all of our business out of the way.
Oh, yeah. Let's do the business.
Yeah. We are Delusions of Granular. We talk about Star Wars. We don't hate about Star Wars. We're a podcast. You can find all of our work on delusionsofgranular.com.
Our hard, hard work. And feel free to say hi to us, like us. Do whatever you want. Poke us if you can on facebook.com/swdog or say hi to us on Twitter at swdog77. Join the conversation.
That's right. Or you can always call us on our hotline number.
Hotline.
It's 651-337-9364. That can also be read as 651-33-SW-DOG.
That's right. And always trust the old reliable email, swdog77@gmail.com. That's the letters swdog and numbers 77@gmail.com. And always feel free to leave us an iTunes review or a Stitcher review if that exists. And
if not, at least if you know of a Star Wars fan, if you like our show, recommend us to them.
Yeah.
We're, you know, word of mouth. That's the way to go.
And if you don't know any Star Wars fans, just do like I did and get your wife pregnant and make a Star Wars fan.
That's right.
You know?
Force your kids to like Star Wars.
It's an investment, but you'll get one, you know? You know, before we toddle off away from all this business, let's address a couple things here. We have the Twitter. We've actually been getting some good Twitter feedback.
Yeah.
I got a little listener feedback lately.
Yeah.
Number one bit of feedback is we need to stop saying...
You know.
You know.
You know.
You know, Ron.
Yeah, you know.
Well, what are you going to do?
I don't know if we do that anymore. Maybe...
Maybe that was an earlier
I don't
episode.
Think we do it as... I mean, I don't think we say it as much as, you know, any other, like...
Well, you know.
Casual conversationalist.
I kind of wonder, it's like, did we say it like... You know, or do we say, like, you know? Like, how are we saying it?
I don't know.
You know?
I read the tweet that we got criticizing us of that, which is fine. We're always open to some, you know, constructive criticism.
Yeah.
As I was reading that tweet, I was actually, you know, editing one of our recent shows. And as I do, I listen to the show, make sure, you know, we're not being racist or...
Right.
Politically incorrect. Mm-hmm. Well, we're politically incorrect always.
Right, but, right.
You know, we don't want to offend people.
Yes, no specific genders or... Right.
We want to offend everybody, but no one in particular.
Yes.
That's our goal.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Sure.
Sure. I didn't hear us say you know that much. Maybe, you know, as a stutter, but I don't think it was, you know, it wasn't a flagrant thing.
Yeah.
So, we'll work on it, you know.
Or you maybe know, we'll develop new tics.
Yeah.
Like, maybe I'll develop a stutter.
That's right. I mean, there's things that, you know, the casual conversationalist does.
Yes.
This isn't a scripted show, so, you know, we're kind of...
The sad off fact the is it is, Ron. all this is very scripted. We're
all
gifted.
Of this is very scripted. You're right.
You know? Anyhow.
Anyway, we'll work on being better broadcasters. We've definitely never went to school for this, so bear with us. We want to speak as good as we
as
can
one.
Talk.
Wouldn't that be great, Ron, if we could actually get to the point where we no longer spoke as co-hosts? We just, like, monotonously spoke at the same time
The time. We're going to get to a point where, like, we're finishing each other's sentences.
Okay. That was a silly bit of business.
All right.
Moving on to random talking points.
Random talking points. Have you seen this Square Enix model kits that are out all over the internet?
I have no idea what that means.
So Square Enix is kind of a... They did the Final Fantasy stuff.
What stuff in particular?
Those video games.
Oh, like, okay.
You know, like that genre of like kind of manga, kind of
RPG, sort of. Yeah, there's a hot girl, there's a vampire, there's a goofy non sequitur. Yeah.
Well, they floating all over the internet is some model kits of Boba Fett and Stormtrooper, and I think even Darth Vader.
Oh.
But they're in the Square Enix style. Like the Final Fantasy style. So they're very stylized, very not Star Wars-y. They're more, you know, anime type of thing.
Sure.
These are floating all over the internet. We have had a couple of people contact us and is like, hey, have you seen these things? I'm like, yeah, they're I don't know, they're Star Wars, but not Star Wars. I don't know. People are going crazy for them.
You know, I think I have seen that. I think I saw it on Slash Film today or yesterday.
Yeah, they've been all over the internet.
I have kind of a banner blindness with that stuff.
Yeah.
Where, like, I literally look at it, like, banner blindness being, like, you know, you don't see those ad banners anymore. Right. You know they're there, but you're not really looking at them.
Mm-hmm.
Just because it just doesn't quite hit me. Like, I dig it. I look at it, I'm like, that's pretty cool.
Right.
And then I just move on.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I would say this. It seems like these model makers that are making the collectibles that people can buy are getting more and more accurate, or should I say detailed.
Specific.
You know, back in the day when I was a kid and buying Star Wars figures, you were lucky if you bought a Luke Skywalker and it looked remotely like Mark Hamill.
I mean, it's still a battle.
It's still a battle. But now they're like... Like, I watched a video today that one of our listeners sent us of a guy he's basically making replicas of the Y-Wing fighter.
Okay.
Right? And what he's actually doing, this is an insane video. I had to watch it. I couldn't believe that there's a guy that actually has the patience to do this.
Mm-hmm.
He's researching, you know, the original Star Wars spaceships, Death Star, whatever.
Yeah.
They took model kits off the shelf and basically broke them apart and used pieces from all these different model kits to make these intricate looking used spaceships that we see in the original movie, right?
Famous heirloom
model stuff, breaking. Yeah. I forgot what the term is, right?
Yeah.
Right. This guy, it's actually a group, right? These group of guys are actually trying to hunt down the original models, the original model kits that were broken apart to make a Y-Wing fighter, okay?
That's amazing.
And then they're going to take that and make a mold out of it and sell that as a model.
Right? God damn.
And they're like four pieces away from it. Like, they're like actually like looking for model kits that were made between 1965 and 1975 that may have been on the shelf when the model makers went to the stores and spent thousands of dollars to take models of, you know, World War II tanks, take them home, break them apart, and it's like, oh, that piece is going to be used on the cockpit of the Y-Wing fighter.
That's amazing. It's one of those amazing things. It's like, it's an idea so simple that you're almost like, how has this not happened before? And then you're like, oh, yeah, the internet.
Like, exactly, right?
You needed that binder.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Another thing I just researched I wanted to bring up, also a thing of the internet, probably, the internet age.
Hmm.
We know that there's the 501st, the Stormtrooper group, guys that dress like Stormtroopers and they're, you know, try to be as accurate to the movies as possible. You know, in order to be a member of the 501st, you have to kind of qualify with your Stormtrooper costume for accuracy. So there's other groups out there. You know, there's a Rebel group out there that has, you know, Rebel costumes and, mm-hmm. you know, you can become a Rebel, you can become a bounty hunter. So getting back to the model thing, there's guys out there that are trying, have been for years now, trying to build accurate life-size models of R2-D2.
Oh, nice.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
Actually
yeah,
building...
I've seen them at cons.
Yeah, yeah, I've seen a life-size R2-D2 at a con. It's awesome, right?
Yeah.
The thing is, they've been building these things for years, or they had been building these things for years.
And they no longer need little men to go inside them.
No, right. They actually work better than the movie version. Right?
Because that's always the question. It's like when one of those comes up near you, you're always like looking around, like, where's the guy with the remote control?
Exactly. No, that's the whole thing.
Is there
right,
a guy
right,
in
right.
there? Yeah.
Well, I'll get to that. Hold on.
Okay.
So the thing is, like, these guys had been building R2-D2 or trying to build replicas of R2-D2 before they had actual dimensions. Like, they didn't have, you know, it was never listed, like,
oh, sure.
the dimensions of R2-D2.
You're just kind of right? guesstimating.
So they were just guesstimating for years, and then finally there was a convention, and one of the guys at the convention, like, quietly on purpose left the storage room open, and these guys were able to go in and measure a real prop, R2-D2, right? And get all the dimensions right, so now that they actually have the right dimensions. But you're right. These guys build, like, accurate versions of R2-D2 to the point where, like, George Lucas, like, saw these guys and is just like, how much did you spend on that? They're like, $10,000. And they're like, yeah, you're going to make the next R2-D2 in, you know, Revenge of the Sith or whatever. Because we're paying $80,000 for one. And you guys are doing it for one eighth of that.
Wow. Like, you kind of, I mean, those are probably the same guys who did the chopper droid and the lead up.
Yeah, drones. Right, totally.
I thought that was the coolest promotional thing for that, where they actually built a real chopper.
Right.
Yeah.
But they work better than the actual movie.
Because you don't have to make a little man.
Well, I mean, technology has gotten better where you can actually, like, they, like you were saying, like, when you see one at a convention and, like, you don't know who's controlling it.
Yeah.
Because the remote control has gotten so sophisticated that they can actually just keep it in their pocket and just stand there and you don't actually see them controlling it.
Oh, man.
And the great, like, the thing that I read about this is, like, these guys, you know, obviously some of these guys are building them. They're building them in their garage, you know, because they're married and their wife doesn't want it in the house, right?
Of course.
R2-D2 is a big fan favorite, right? But he's also a fan favorite, not only all fans, but women in particular dig on R2-D2.
Oh.
Right?
I guess that's kind of true.
Yeah.
He's cute.
Yeah, he's cute. Right.
Yeah.
So these guys are, like, going to these conventions and going up to, like, the hot girls.
Oh, right? Nice.
And kind of, like being a little bit lewd with them.
Oh, man. How many guys, like...
Like, R2-D2 is being lewd. Sure. Like, the guys aren't. Like, they're sitting in the background and just,
collecting,
like...
collecting their upskirts.
Yeah, they're, like, living vicariously through a tin can.
Wow.
You know? Like, yeah, it's
the
just...
The dark side.
It's just an interesting thing, and I thought it was interesting...
What book did you read this out?
So I read it. It was a book by a man named Chris Taylor.
Oh, he wrote the author's name on here. Yeah. Nice.
It's How Star Wars Conquered the World.
I've heard of this. Yeah. I actually heard that guy on another program.
Yeah, it's a good read. I'll definitely have some future ideas for the show from that book. There was a lot of interesting things in there.
Little tease out there.
I thought, since we were talking about model makers of today, why not the pinnacle of model making actually making
upskirt
droid, a real upskirt droid.
Yeah,
right.
That's just great.
That's right. Well,
do we have any Force Awakens news?
I don't think we have any Force Awakens news. We have some Rogue One news.
Rogue One. We still don't know what Rogue One is.
We do not.
But we do now have a actor cast, correct?
I believe he's cast or rumored to be cast.
I can't tell what's real and what's not anymore, Ron. I mean that in all aspects of my life.
Well, I'm right there with you.
Ben Mendelsohn is either rumored or cast.
As a part something. In Rogue One.
Yeah, something.
Yeah.
He's in the Netflix TV show Bloodlines right now. He's been in a ton of junk, though.
Yeah, I have no idea who this guy is.
Like, I guess he's... In the past few years, he's gotten a lot of acclaim. He was in A Place Beyond the Pines, Killing Them Softly, Animal Kingdom.
Hmm.
The Dark Knight Rises. Not sure what he played there.
He was in The Dark Knight Rises?
I don't remember anything from Dark Knight Rises.
Well.
And then a bunch of kind of artsier pictures. Adore... Oh, he's in Trespass. I'm just
completely interesting. Interesting.
But his roots go back to Vertical Limit.
So this guy has kind of been a bit player, I guess.
Yeah, it seems like it. Knocked around for a long time.
Knocked around for a while. So he may or may not be cast in Rogue One. But you know him from, was it Bloodline?
Bloodline. Yeah.
So this is a Netflix original show?
Yes, and it's the slowest television show I've ever watched.
Hmm.
I mean, that counts Mad Men and anything else you want to throw in there. But it's really paying off. I'm not finished with it yet, but I'm on episode like 7 or 8.
All right.
And and he's really good.
He's good in it.
And he does a good thing where he's like very likable and very chilling.
Okay.
So he could be a great Imperial officer or great all right. Anything.
All right. Well, I will. I'll have to check that out because I like to check out what these actors that have been cast had done before Star Wars.
Well, you know what's interesting, Ron?
Yes. With every new Star Wars property, mm-hmm. be it a Rebels, Clone Wars, surely Force Awakens, even Rogue One, they all bring a new facet to the Star Wars universe.
I smell a segue coming here.
I don't know what you mean. did I get on my segue right away? No. What about the stuff for the kids, Ron? Can that bring anything?
What about the stuff for the kids?
You know?
Yeah, it's interesting. Star Wars is for kids, right? You know?
Yeah, sure.
For kids. we're diving into something tonight that, honestly, never thought we would actually go there.
Right.
Don't know many Star Wars fans that I have had witness to that have gone there.
I've never heard anyone talk about it.
Nobody talks about this, and yet it's there. It's there and it's big, right?
Yeah.
All right, 20 minutes into it. What are we talking about tonight?
The Yoda Chronicles.
The Yoda Chronicles. Not just the Yoda Chronicles.
Star Wars Lego.
The Yoda Chronicles.
That's what I was talking about earlier. We could do the whole podcast like that.
Yeah, folks, we're going to talk about Legos tonight.
Yeah, and I gotta say, I'm just gonna not even bury the lead on this one, even though we're 20 minutes in. I think this is the best expanded non-film Star Wars thing I've gotten into.
Oh yeah, this is great fun.
I mean, this is awesome.
This is great fun. This is hilariously fun.
This was on.
How did we figure out that this existed in the first place?
I knew it was a Star Wars Legos thing. I knew they had minisodes. Yeah. I didn't know what it was all about. The Disney XD app, which we have access to, which is how we watch Rebels, always had the Yoda Chronicles on there, and it just looked like such a little kiddie thing.
Totally. Yeah. Totally. It's a very kid-friendly rendered version of Yoda.
Well, you know how when you go into there's no toy stores anymore. You go into a Target, and there's there'll be the Superman action figures, the Spider-Man action figures, and stuff. But then down the aisle, maybe the aisle over, there'll be Superman and Spider-Man and stuff. But they'll have big heads and be all bobbly and they're for preschoolers.
Sure,
that's what this.
That's what Yoda looks like.
Yeah. I thought this was totally. The Yoda Chronicles was for the preschoolers.
Right. So. As JP was saying, we're aware that Legos did Star Wars. They have the license for Star Wars.
Oh, yeah.
They've been doing Lego sets for years, since the prequels, I think the first Lego set I ever bought for Star Wars was for Phantom Menace.
I've never been a guy to buy Lego sets.
Okay.
So I don't know.
No, collector, I had to buy everything, Yeah. I believe that it was around Phantom Menace, so 1999-ish. I know that as a kid, I was in Vietnam.
Had a necklace of ears.
That's our new running joke, necklace of ears. But I know as a kid I had Lego sets and I would try to make Star Wars.
That game I played hard.
Right? Yes. And then, 20 years later, oh, Lego's actually making Star Wars sets.
Yeah, see, that was the thing. I don't know if it was because I am of a generation where there were Lego sets, but I don't know if my parents just didn't get them or what, but I had a couple small ones.
Sure.
But in general...
because they're so damn expensive.
Yeah, I mean, now, I guess. But I just played with the blocks, and honestly, I think it was more fun. I was never... you might as well make models.
Sure.
So...
Yeah, so...
That said... The content they make.
Oh yeah, these sets are great. I wish I could afford them. I wish I could afford the space to make them. I mean,
do you ever go up to that display in Target?
Oh yeah,
that has all the toys laid out.
Yeah,
all the. Because sometimes I want some good Star Wars action figures.
Right.
And I feel like those are actually the closest we have right now.
Yeah, the Star Wars sets are quality stuff. I wanted to bring up this. This note that I read. So back in the late 90s, early 2000s,
yes.
The CEO of Star Wars, or I'm sorry, the CEO of Legos.
Oh, okay.
He didn't want to do the license for Star Wars. Yes. He doesn't really give a a good reason why. But he's just like, no, I don't want to do that, right? Mm. But they twisted his arm and is like, I'm sorry, this was the vice president. Vice president of Lego is like, no, I'm not gonna license Lego or Star Wars to Lego. Right?
He's not gonna license
Star Wars
from Lucasfilm for Lego.
Yes, exactly. Right.
Lego is a whole culture unto itself.
Yes. Danish company, right?
Yeah, I used to work for a boss who was a Lego head. One of those crazy guys who, like, he went and, like, for his vacation, he went and met one of the original Lego architects or whatever.
Right. So, I need to say this fact because this really sets the tone for where what we're going to talk about comes from.
Lay it down,
right? The CEO of, not the vice president who is against it, but the CEO of Lego was a Star Wars fan. And he basically won the executives of Lego over and got the Star Wars license. Okay. Mm-hmm. And from 1999, when they first got the license, to 2000, basically a year, mm-hmm. they made $2 million worth of Star Wars Legos.
Wow.
$2 million in 1 year, just because they put Star Wars on the box.
Sure. Right? And that's after figuring in the cost of paying for the license.
Yeah, right. I mean, like, that's insane. Like, Star Wars Legos are kind of bigger in the toy aisle now than just the Star Wars regular.
They have their own aisle.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Yeah. Like, it literally takes up half an aisle of just Star Wars toys. And then I go to the actual Star Wars, like, action figures, and it's like a sliver of an aisle.
Yeah, right.
It's all busted up. Silly shit. Half yeah. Rebels, half Star Wars Black, half yeah. thrown away, whatever.
Exactly.
Sad.
So, like we were saying, we were watching the Rebels, Star Wars Rebels, on the Disney XD app. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the app is kind of set up. It's kid-friendly. You know, the mm-hmm. interface is very kid-friendly. There's a lot of pictures, bright colors of, you know, all the other shows that are on there. You know, we mentioned before that we were like very curious about some of the other shows, having gone through the app and watched Rebels. You know, there seems to be some interesting things on there.
Yeah, I take my iPad on job interviews and stuff.
Yeah, and you watch the show on the while you're
on the iPad
while you're at the interview.
Well, yeah. They walk in, I turn it on. I'm like, let's watch this. And if they don't laugh, they don't enjoy it. Yeah. Then I
don't want to work here.
Yeah, but last time I was opening something and like. I had the Disney XD app still open, and yeah. like it has that loading screen. It's like big, bright.
No, it's
like,
yeah,
Disney
it's big, XD. Very yeah. kid friendly, big,
and
I was bright
like,
colors.
Oh, and, you know, I'm like click it off, and yeah. they're like, "Oh, you got kids?" I'm like,
"Nope,
no, we're expecting, but no kids." And she's like, "Oh, I'm oh. like, yes." Moving on. it's like there was that moment of hesitation where I was like, I could go into it and explain that, like, I watch this show every week because I have this podcast and we right. talk about.
yeah, same experience I've had.
Okay. So Star Wars Lego, they try to get the license, and it's just like printing money.
Right.
Yeah.
We knew that Lego sets exist.
Yes.
We knew even that there were Lego games exist.
Yeah. Right? My roommates had these circa 2007.
Yeah, I've played somewhat the games. The games are fun. They're very lighthearted. They kind of poke fun at the license, but still
yeah.
honor it. You know, I think that's what can be said about anything that's created by Lego is they poke fun of what the license is, but still remain true.
Yeah, I think that's true. They're kind of, I mean, like inherently they're yellow and like bubbly and goofy. You know, so it's like you're not going to get a hardcore Lego,
right?
I mean, yeah, you wouldn't want it.
Yeah. So we're on the app. We're watching Rebels. We're reporting on Rebels. Yep. And as we're scrolling through the app, we keep coming across this Yoda Chronicles thing.
It starts to beckon to us.
Yeah. This thing looks like it's for babies.
Yeah, and
it's like baby Star Wars.
And you are not a fan of Yoda.
I'm not a fan of Yoda, so I'm just like, yeah.
I am a fan of Yoda, and the name itself captured my mind. I was like,
Yoda Chronicles. Yoda Chronicles.
Even if it's for children, I'm kind of interested in seeing what Yoda's doing.
Sure.
Period.
Sure. So we thought that that would be a good topic for the show, and then we would just dive into the show as if we were 6 year olds.
Yeah, and it's just like, you know what? Here's the baby content. It's okay. There's a couple funny gags.
We would report on it, and as we did for the Clone Wars, as we did for Rebels, we would tell you, is it worth your time and effort to watch the show?
Exactly. We were going to take the hit for you guys.
That's right. Yeah. And as we've alluded to, we believe that this is definitely worth your time and effort. You should watch this because this is a great, great fucking show.
If you love all six movies and the TV show, The Clone Wars,
yeah,
you'll love it. If you only like the original trilogy, you'll really love it.
Yeah.
Like, it's great either way. Like, there's a lot of prequel content. It's predominantly prequel. But they are so good about honoring...
They poke fun at so much in a very respectful way. Let's just run down the fact that Yoda is not my favorite character. Never been. I kind of... Back in the day, with the VHS, watching Empire Strikes Back, I would always fast forward through the Dagobah scenes. Just been there, done that. Don't need to do it again.
Sure.
Yoda bores me.
Sure.
I will say flat out, Yoda is probably the best character in this show.
Well, second best, right?
Well, I mean, Yoda really ties it together.
But, I mean, number one. It's
got to
be C-3PO.
C-3PO?
Right.
3POC? 3POC. Yeah. They do a great job of taking the characters that kind of are the snoozers.
Yes.
You got your Palpatine, you got your Grievous, you got your Dooku, you got your Yoda, you got your Windu, you got your Obi-Wan, kind of a stick in the mud. Right, sure. Your 3PO,
and don't
Chrissy.
Get your OT characters too. Eventually, we get Han, Luke.
Right. But I'm talking about the characters that I guess, in my opinion, are the drier characters of the actual movies.
Poggle the Lesser.
You got them.
Yeah.
In this, all of them are there.
Yep.
And they're hilarious.
Oh
like
my
Yoda
god.
Yoda is hilarious. The Emperor. Probably is not only hilarious, but actually a better characterization of the Emperor / Senator Palpatine or Chancellor Palpatine than the movies.
Well, you know what's weird? I'm not going to say it's a better characterization, but I will say there's something to the way they satirize. Like, it's so funny they're talking about the show like this.
And this is satire.
Yeah.
This is totally satire. It's totally parody satire. Yeah.
It's great, but there's something about the way they do it. Like we said, it's been respectful and stuff, but it actually reveals more about the actual plot of the films and the characterization.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Like, it's not just like taking a surface element of the character and like making fun of it. Like, he's got a silly hat.
Right.
Like, it's actually like getting to the core of the character. It's very impressive.
Right. Well, okay, so.
Well, I guess it's geared, like, even though there's so many jokes that fly above kids' heads,
yeah.
Like, it's kind of like old school Looney Tunes stuff, where 60% of the gags are, you know, slapping gags and stuff that anyone can laugh at, and 40% are just for the adults.
Yeah.
It's that kind of formula.
I don't know which way I want to run with this. At the
I know,
moment.
That's the thing.
Like, it's so like, oh my god, I got to tell everyone this
right
now.
Yeah, like, I just want to run down this like gush list of like funny lines.
Yeah, let's let's start with the beginning.
Yes.
The Star Wars.
Sorry.
The Star Wars video game. The original one came out in 2005. Okay. Huh. That was the year that Revenge of the Sith came out.
Okay? Yeah.
So this was really kind of the beginning of Legos becoming more than just a brick company. They were actually making some movies.
It's also the year I went to college.
All right.
I went away to college.
The year 2005, I was doing something. but, like, up until this point, you know, Legos were really just considered a physical toy.
Yeah, I remember kind of scoffing at it when I started seeing Lego, like, T-shirts,
yeah.
Lego, like various merchandising that wasn't just the bricks. Yeah, just the dick blick.
The dick blick.
when I started seeing like kids with t-shirts, all that stuff. Yeah. It's like the Angry Birds of the day.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, Lego did a good job of, you know, taking a... taking their icon that had been around for years and really making it into a recognizable worldwide icon is the little yellow guy.
Yeah.
You know, the yellow head, you know, stubby body that fits into all of the bricks, you know, like he can connect into all the bricks, but that yellow-headed, you know, guy that can have different bodies but, you know, same shape, can have hair, can have a helmet, can have whatever.
That's funny. I said we both said we didn't really get a lot of the sets, but we both.
It's very it's a very recognizable thing, and Lego did a good job of marketing that, is making that kind of their icon.
Yeah,
right? To the point where they made a movie last year where that is the main character, right? The non recognizable guy,
and we should get to that
generic guy. Yeah,
yeah.
So. Anyway, 2005, they make a video game. Okay, this is a big thing. Like, they were known as just kind of being a physical toy. Now they're getting into video games. And the video games are fun. I've only played a little bit, but they're fun because you can actually kind of take your environment and pull bricks out of the environment and make things that help you get through the video game.
I've played a few different. Different ones, like there's a Batman, there's probably several Batman ones.
Yeah.
But I played a Batman one, I played a Star Wars one, and I think far and away the most satisfying and bittersweet thing is when you die, getting blown apart.
Yeah,
it's always like, it's a satisfying, like, you know,
your Lego parts bricks. Just fall apart. Like, it, all of a sudden it becomes much more fun than just building things. Like, oh, wait, this is a thing. This is a entity unto itself, right? So 2006, they make the second Star Wars video game called the Original Trilogy, okay? And this is basically the entire first three movies. And then 2007, they make the Complete Saga, which is now a video game that covers all six movies, mm-hmm. okay?
Yes.
And then 2011, they make an actual video game for the Clone Wars, right? That's how big this has gotten. Lego is now taking their flavor of parody and applying it to a cartoon show on Cartoon Network that, you know, not everyone is even watching at that time.
Right.
So at the same time, because Lego is, you know, I mean, Lego is kind of the epitome of the capitalism at its best, even though they're a Danish company.
There must be. I mean, if we knew more about Lego.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where it's like we could easily transition and become a Lego podcast after this.
Oh, yeah, right.
Because, like, there's so much wealth of information here. Like, I've just been Googling stuff as we've been talking. And, like, there must be some superhero account man, marketing
there
man.
There has to be, right?
Who is the guy who broke
there's
the
a marketing
code.
Genius here.
Yeah.
Because essentially what this is, I mean, to sum up Legos, it's like, okay, the Legos are in the market of selling toys.
Right.
Right? And now they're making video games that sell the toys, and the toys are selling the video game.
Well,
it's become a full circle of like, there's shorts and there's films it's a commercial selling a commercial selling a product selling a commercial selling a product.
And I feel like it started with we're in the toy stores, the action figures in the toy stores. We're both by each other.
Yeah.
But you know, at a certain point the kids quit buying us and they start buying the action figures. We gotta keep the kids longer, gotta fight against the action figures. So you make the Bionicle.
Right.
$4.99.
Right.
And, you know, then you go forward from there, and then it's like, we're still not competing. We need the licenses. The kids like the things they know. They like the Batman, you know? They like the Star Wars.
Right.
And then as time goes on, they start bringing in these licenses. And whoever the guy was that cracked the code and convinced all these people, it's like, no, your character can be our little yellow man.
Yeah.
They all can be.
They all can.
Because he's all of us.
Right.
Don't you wish that's like such a Don Draper pitch moment, I bet?
Oh, yeah. Like, I mean, I will say this, like, having read that book and, like, how Star Wars conquered the world.
Yeah.
Like, I would say this, okay? We are both graphic designers by trade.
Yes.
Right? So that kind of makes us Apple nerds by trade.
God,
right?
Man.
Yeah. Right? Apple is a company that I think you and I both kind of
fear and respect.
Fear and respect, sure.
Yes.
I would say as a brand, Apple is something that has historically been looked up as being quality. It's a quality brand. It's a quality good.
Yeah, I mean, right? Between the two of us, we have 5 Apple products on the table right now.
Yeah. And my Apple tattoo.
Oh, yeah.
So we have Apple.
Yep.
We have Star Wars, which has become a brand unto itself, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think Lego is in that league, right? Lego is a brand that's, I mean, always been quality toys. You never get a Lego set and it's like, well, this doesn't work.
Yeah.
You know, or this is a piece of crap.
Well,
or this isn't, you know, like all of them, I think the connection here is Apple, Star Wars, Lego, probably some other brands I'm not thinking of, right? They're all very creative brands. Right, they prize creativity. They push creativity forward. They push imagination forward.
Sure.
Right? So, linking two of them together, Star Wars and Lego together,
yeah,
that's a no-brainer.
But,
right?
But I would also argue, and here's the other thing, and the dystopian vision of that is that there's also fewer and fewer brands like that.
Yes.
Because for whatever reason, and I'm going to put forth that it's because. The reason the brands you named, Apple, Star Wars, and Lego, are still with us is because they each had a genius marketer at the center of them.
Yeah.
Because Lincoln Logs, still around,
still
exists.
Yep.
But doesn't seem to have the scalability of a Lego.
Right.
Right?
Also, a Lincoln Log looks like a turd at the end of the day.
Yeah, you know, I mean, you really can only make so much stuff with them.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's not that much variation.
Yeah. Yeah,
they're wooden toys.
Tinker toys.
Yeah.
Tinker toys, maybe.
Well, what are those things that Erector sets?
Connects. Oh yeah, Erector sets. I've had all these things as a kid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they don't have Erector sets. Why did that take off?
I don't know.
More.
Probably because they were metal and they probably cut kids like severe like metal cuts.
Yeah, they bend.
Yeah.
You know, they bake something big and it bend.
Yeah.
Dumb toys.
Lego had it. Lego has it down.
Yeah.
And they are on their way to, you know. As Star Wars did, as Apple did.
Eerie question.
Conquering the world.
Eerie question.
Yeah.
How many kids do you think have died choking on Lego toys?
Oh, like dozens.
Like, I mean, is there like enough to fill a graveyard?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah. That's ghastly.
Yeah. I mean, how many... Not as grim, but like, how many people have cut their foot, their bare foot, stepping on a Lego block?
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Like, those things are...
Not to mention, the collateral damage.
Yeah, that's like painful.
The father who walks down the carpeted steps at night, and his Legos all over.
You step on a Lego in the middle of the night, you're in serious pain.
Yeah, fall, break your neck.
Yeah.
Dead.
All right. So, 2005, Lego also starts to make some Star Wars films, okay? And I use the word film lightly.
Sure.
Okay?
I mean, they're short.
They're shorts.
Yeah.
They're commercials. I mean, seriously.
Well, as a child who grew up in the 80s with Transformers and what have you, you know, I'm used to my media being commercials.
I mean, this is the circle I'm trying to get to. Uh-huh. It's like
the snake eating its own tail.
They're making films to sell the toys, to get people to watch the films, to, you know, like it's very circular, okay?
Yeah.
What is driving what, right?
Mm-hmm.
But they're making these Star Wars films. Legos. Still Legos, right? And they're shorts. They're, you know, from anywhere from a minute and a half to like 5 minutes long. The early ones were called Revenge of the Brick.
Right? Yep.
The Quest for R2-D2.
Mm-hmm.
The Bombad Bounty, right?
Bombad Bounty.
Guess who that is?
Yeah.
It's a Jar Jar specific episode, right?
Love Jar Jar.
Right, and those were very, like, if you go to Lego.com, you can watch a lot of these.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
They're on there. They're short. They're, you know, like we said, they're a few minutes.
For such a forward-facing company, I wish they would kind of update the website a little bit.
Hard yeah, to navigate. It's a little bit hard to navigate.
Or maybe just, guys, hey, I know it's all cool to be proprietary and stuff, but why don't you just dump it all on YouTube?
Dump it on YouTube,
yeah, actually curate your YouTube channel. Make it really nice.
Yeah.
That's the way to do it.
Yeah.
Google's not going nowhere. And you're all for co-sponsoring things. So.
Yeah. Some of the things I notice about these early films, the real early ones, the animation is kind of poor.
Sure, yeah.
Right?
A lot of drawn-on faces looking.
Well, yeah, some of the character models really were rough.
Yeah, you know, and these are all that kind of 3D anime. You know the way a Lego cartoon looks, right, guys?
Yeah, they're. I mean, if you've seen the Lego movie, these are kind of like really low-rent versions of it.
Exactly.
Right? There's times where they've tried to be more realistic with the character models, which doesn't work. Like, they don't have yellow faces. They have more sculpted faces.
Oh, right? Yeah. That didn't bother me so bad.
But. Some of it, I mean, it looks a little bit weird. There's a point where, like, Yoda looks realistic and it's like, something's wrong with Yoda. Right? Uh-huh. It just doesn't work with the format. But then as they go along, they start to get better. You know, they seem to be progressing. Early on, they also didn't have voice acting, so a lot of the dialogue is more grunts.
Right.
Right? They didn't have voice acting talent on this yet, which makes sense. I mean, they were just kind of, you know, floating this out there as a new thing in the universe. So I think it was around 2010, 2011 when they really got their shit together, right? They came out with the it's called Lego Star Wars The Padawan Menace.
And this would be what we kind of consider the dark time of Star Wars.
This is, as far as Star Wars overall.
We are far enough away from the Sith now, Revenge of the Sith, that, like, it's a memory. We're in 2010.
Yeah. Like, people are kind of...
People who saw it in college aren't in college anymore. People who saw it in high school aren't in high school anymore.
Yeah. The old OT fans, they're completely, like, dead on Star Wars. They're like, oh, thank God this thing's over with.
Yeah, and I mean, a lot of people were burnt out. I mean, it was... If you were there when the prequel thing happened, Star Wars was everywhere. You know?
Well, there was one thing going on. The Clone Wars.
Yeah.
The Clone Wars was going on.
Yeah, it was.
Okay? Whether people were watching it or not...
Around season 2 or 3 at this point.
Yeah. Whether people were watching it or not, the Clone Wars was going on. You know, George Lucas was actively involved in it, mentoring Dave Filoni.
I would love for... Like, I just wish someone would get an interview with George Lucas where he talks about, like, what that was like.
Yeah.
Because it had to be kind of weirdly invigorating again to be, like, kind of the underdog again.
Well,
he spent all the money.
I think we can get into that a little bit later.
Like, yeah, let's do that.
How Star Wars conquered the universe. It kind of talks a little bit more about that.
Well,
those empty years.
Our big George Lucas episode maybe someday.
Maybe. So.
We're just putting the pieces together.
So, right before this episode, we watched The Padawan Menace.
Yeah.
It was actually made it onto DVD. It was a...
Best animated of the whole lot, I think.
It was... Yeah, it was...
Beautiful.
Yeah. Very, very well done. Yoda is obviously our main character, but as you alluded to, one of the other main characters of these, all of these, pretty much is standout 3PO.
Well, because the Clone Wars did a lot of great things.
Yeah.
One of the things they didn't necessarily nail was 3PO was great in about one episode.
I agree.
And everything else, he kind of served the same purpose he did in all the prequel movies. Just kind of around.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Hey, there he is. He's part of Star Wars.
Right. 3PO on this is front and center.
Yeah, because 3PO really is only a big... I mean, Return of the Jedi, they give him his due. You know, he's going to be worshipped as a god and stuff. But it's really the first one where you get to see the real 3PO.
Yeah.
A New Hope.
Yeah.
And this really gets you back to that character. It's like, oh, that's right. He's not always passive. Like,
I think it gets to be such a cliche about him. You know, he's always this fey little robot who doesn't do much.
Right.
But he's like, he's got like a determination to him that's like,
yeah,
hilarious.
Yeah, this is
because of his demeanor.
This, it's funny how they latched upon this character and really made him more of a hero than R2-D2, which I think, you know, even all the movies is...
They did have a good R2-D2, you know, moment where Darth Vader is... He's been bested by Luke and R2, and he has to... You know, he's talking to the Emperor, and he's apologizing. And the Emperor's like, what happened? It's like, what is... His R2 unit, you know, and it's like, oh, come, an R2
it's
unit?
It's just an R2 unit.
He's like, no, the R2-D2.
R2-D2. He's famous.
Yeah, it's like it's very meta in that way. That like, yeah. In this world, R2-D2 is famous. He's an amazing warrior,
right,
which he should be.
Right. So you bring up a good point.
Yeah.
All of these, like, all these shows that we're talking about, Lego episodes that we're talking about, we haven't even gotten to the actual Yoda Chronicles, which is what our show is properly about.
Right.
They're very meta. They poke fun at themselves constantly,
yeah,
in a very lighthearted kind way,
mm-hmm,
but they're constantly like poking fun at themselves, right? To a point where like they poke fun at themselves where a fan of... Whether you're a fan of the OT, fan of the prequels, you'll appreciate the way they're making fun of themselves, right?
Well, it's... And for a show that calls itself Delusions of Granular, like, as granular as you want to go, the jokes are there. Like you pointed out,
yes,
to me that one of the little Padawans...
One of the little Padawans. So there's a group of young Padawans that are kind of the stars of this, although not really, but they're there in
the
most...
They're the avatars.
Yeah, they're in most episodes. One of them is named Ashla, as we all know, is a reference to the Ashla and the Bogan.
Ashla and the Boogish.
Right. The Boogish. So, you know, they're getting very meta with this, and they're also getting, I forgot what my other point was. They're very meta.
Yes.
And,
well, and also they're just telling a great story.
Yes.
That's what's impressive,
yes,
is that, like, it would be one thing if it was just a collection of, like, funny parodies of Star Wars moments and stuff. Like, Family Guy. Family Guy does a great job of that.
Right.
They nail that.
Right.
But this actually creates new situations and builds a story that, like, as a Star Wars fan, the whole time I'm not feeling like, oh, you're just shitting on my thing, because you're actually telling a new Star Wars story at the same time.
Right. Yeah, this is... I threw it in our notes. You know, we've had parodies in Star Wars. We've had Family Guy. We've had Robot Chicken. We've had going all the way back to Spaceballs and Hardware Wars, right?
Oh, yeah.
Right? One thing that Star Wars and Lucasfilm has always been good at is embracing the parodies. They don't shut these people down for doing this stuff. They embrace it. They as much as the... you know, the shitty fanboy on the internet is, you know, making fun of Star Wars for whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Star Wars is going to, you know, self-deprecate themselves before anyone else. You know, Han shot first. Lucas is going to wear a t-shirt on set of Indiana Jones that said Han shot first. You know, like, they've always been very good at humor and poking fun at it and being open to humor.
Definitely.
Right? The thing that Lego, Star Wars, and Yoda Chronicles in particular does is, like, you go to a Family Guy, you go to a Robot Chicken, you go to a Spaceballs, right? That, a lot of that humor is very particular, especially a Family Guy. It isn't Star Wars humor. It's Family Guy humor.
Sure,
right?
Spaceballs isn't really Star Wars humor.
It's Mel Brooks humor.
Right. You're absolutely right. That's a very interesting insight.
All of the jokes in this are very Star Wars.
Deep Star Wars.
Deep Star Wars. But not so deep Star Wars. Like, they're constantly making fun of Yoda the way he talks.
Oh, yeah. They'll make fun of how he talks, and then they'll also be like, who's that little green boy?
Who's that little green boy?
Yeah.
Yeah. Or Han Solo, because at a certain point in these episodes, and, like, track these down They're on iTunes. They're on.
They're on YouTube.
They're on YouTube. Well, some of them are on YouTube, yeah. But you can
get a flavor for it.
Yeah, you can get a flavor for it. But they're definitely on iTunes. Definitely go to Lego.com. Like, you can get some of these episodes. But there's a little kid Han Solo / Yoda team up.
Yeah.
Like, one whole episode is basically Han is a kid with Yoda, and Han is calling Yoda Yo-Yo. Yo-Yo.
Well, the thing is, like,
and that may sound silly.
Yeah.
But it works, folks. It's damn funny.
The shocking thing about it is all of the plots that they give us are, like, first off, they make jokes. Hold on. They make jokes about all the things you would expect. Like, it's a trap. There's jokes about the fact that, you know, Grievous doesn't ever have anything to do.
Yeah.
There's jokes about the Senate is boring.
Yeah.
They, you know, all that kind of, like, stuff you'd expect.
Kiddie stuff, sure.
And then there's a second level. To me, when I was watching, I broke it down as three levels. There's that surface level of, like, Star Wars funny haha gags.
Right.
And there's a second level of, like, they're actually making a plot. Like, one plot that runs through the full actual Yoda Chronicles. This character, Jack 14. Jack 14 is one of the original clones he's actually cloned from a Sith.
A Sith.
So he's going to have Sith powers.
Right.
And it's one of those things that this whole cartoon show does is that it's like, that's such a simple kid idea.
Yeah.
It's like, well, what if the clones weren't of Boba Fett or Jango Fett?
Right.
What if they were of the Emperor?
Right.
And it's like, oh. And then you just see it and it's like, but because there's that low entry level expectation.
Yeah.
Actually watching it, it's like, this is kind of a fun, cool story.
Yeah.
And the Jack character continues on and becomes like, pretty badass.
He's kind of a badass character. Yeah. It's like a glowing arm. And that's where his power is.
And like, it's one of those things where at first I was like, this is ridiculous. And then as I kept watching it, I was like, why didn't the movies do more with something like this?
He had a crossroads in it.
Yeah.
Where Yoda and Palpatine. And Palpatine is a ridiculously funny character in this. Right? Yes. Like, the evil dude is hilarious in this.
Oh,
yeah. Right? They are both like, they're fighting with this Jack character, right? And Yoda's like, turn to the light side. And Palpatine is, turn to the dark side. And this is the moment where I was like, oh, wait. This show is actually about something else.
Mm.
It's not just a kid show. Because the Jack character is like, no. I don't want to do either of your ways. I just want to go off and do my own thing. I want to build things.
Yeah.
Right? I want to create things.
Yeah.
And he's like, fuck you guys. Like, I don't want to do either of yours. And it's like, wow. That's almost that. I mean, that equals like Ahsoka walking away from the Jedi Order is just like, ah, fuck this, fuck all of this Jedi shit. Screw you guys.
It's like a little broader interpretation of that kind of thing. And what's cool is he also is a character that shows up later on when we get to when they start doing the Luke and Han era, and like he comes back older, grayer, more grizzled. And
looks like Lucas.
Yeah, he does a little bit. And they call him out of retirement and stuff. So that's the other level where it's like, they bothered to write really engaging stories. And we'll talk about the writer in just a minute.
Yeah.
But the third level for me was that there's something viscerally like Star Wars about some of the things they do.
It's the most Star Wars thing that I've watched in such a long time. I've watched the Clone Wars.
Yeah.
I've watched Rebels. I've watched prequels. This, to me, is like, oh, my God. Like there's something inherently fun about watching Star Wars spaceships built out of Lego being blown apart in space and then coming back together because of the Force. And it's like, with John Williams' music behind it. And it's like, wow, this feels like Star Wars.
For me, it was even more simple. It was like, I told this to you a couple times already. There's a shot where they go to Jabba's palace and the Rancor is released or escapes and it's running through the desert of Tatooine free. And I was just like, this is such a, like, why didn't I see this in the movies?
Yeah.
Like,
it's fun.
There's something, yeah, fun. It's just fun. Something that, like, really activates that, like, wish fulfillment of, like, when you were a kid watching these, where it's like, man, I wonder what that thing looks like in the wild. You know what I mean?
Right.
It was cool. Right. Like, and there's a lot of that sort of stuff that really, really worked for me.
Yeah. So let's talk about the some of the background people, the creators of the show.
Yes.
Right?
Numero uno, the only name I know offhand is Michael Price.
Michael Price. Michael Price is the writer, director of some
writer,
of the shows.
Writer, producer or something.
Writer, producer. Okay. So, first of all, this was going on at the same time as the Clone Wars. So, Filoni was not involved, but the guy who did the opening of the Clone Wars kind of did that voiceover kind of...
Ahsoka Tano!
Yeah, the, you know, the very radio serial voiceover.
When we last saw our heroes.
Yeah, yeah.
Which he does, I love. And
yeah, he, but he does this too. He, like, he's in this too. Like, he does, he reads basically the crawls.
Oh, yeah, the voice of Yoda returns. A few voice actors.
Well, that's the guy who does Yoda. It's the same guy.
No shit.
Yeah.
God damn, man. Same voice guy. Actors.
Yeah. Yeah. Also, two characters, two actors that are very well known for the Star Wars
character
movies.
Character actors, you might say.
Anthony Daniels.
Mm-hmm. And Lando Calrissian.
And... Billy D. Williams himself.
I saw it on your face that you'd like lost it for a second.
Oh my god. Lando, yeah.
Lando and C-3PO show up.
Lando and C-3PO show up. No, they Billy D. and and Anthony Daniels have sworn that as long as they're alive, they will own their characters. Anthony Daniels has always been the voice of C-3PO on everything.
Literally.
Continues to be the voice of C-3PO and everything. And Lando shows up, or Billy D shows up as Lando's father.
Yeah.
Lindo.
That's right.
Lindo.
On the party wagon.
On the party wagon that is the Millennium Falcon. The Millennium Falcon is the moving nightclub of the Star Wars universe in this. It's all lit up in neon and just... decked out in Saturday Night Fever, disco floors, and Yoda's drinking, and Mace Windu is dancing, and basically, Lindo Calrissian is there with his son Lando, and they're there to bring the funk to the Star Wars universe.
Pretty much, yeah. I mean, yeah.
But the main creator is, you said, Michael Price?
Yes, Michael Price, known for... he's been a executive producer slash writer on The Simpsons since 2003.
Okay.
Right up till today. So that's kind of my blind spot era for Simpsons.
Sure. Yeah, I think a lot of us have given up on The Simpsons by then.
So, but watching this goes to show that there's at least one talented guy still working on that show.
Yeah, I mean, this is fun. Fun. And good on Michael Price to be...
I read an interview with him where he was talking about the licensing process and dealing with Lucasfilm and Lucas licensing and stuff.
Yeah.
Arnold Rothman, right?
Yes. Yeah. Harold Rothman.
Harold. Not Arnold.
Yeah.
And he said that they were very easygoing. He's like, you know, they said, do what you want. And so I made, you know, he's made a bunch of jokes, some that were like trying to be respectful, but still like, you know, this stuff you gotta poke fun at. You gotta make fun of Jar Jar. You gotta make fun of how boring the Senate is.
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, they never. He got no notes.
Yeah, they never backed down the whole time. Which is it's very interesting because from what I've read, when the Disney takeover happened, you know, bringing Kathleen Kennedy on board, she was not to villainize her, but she took a look at the Clone Wars series and is like, look, this isn't really making a lot of money for us. I think we should cancel it. You know, I think our money would be better spent elsewhere. Because at that point, like, I mean, Lucas was outright funding that show and they were spending like $2 million like an episode or something ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like, to make that for a cartoon and you know, like, it was just a smart business decision to kind of just be like, yeah, this is done. Let's focus our energy somewhere else and put our dollars somewhere else where they'd be better well spent.
I gotta say, honestly, I on the one hand, like you said, you have to vilify her where you want to be like, God damn it. But on the other hand, it's like, I don't know if it needed to go much longer.
Right. I think they really were like five seasons was kind of where it needed to go.
Yeah.
You know, the six was kind of the wrap up.
Mm-hmm. It's only covering a span of like 3 years.
Yeah. So. Well, the
big years.
They also, you know, the book I was reading, How Star Wars Conquered the Universe, they said that like the show was running into the problem that MASH ran into, where it was like the Clone Wars are actually like the series is taking longer than the actual wars itself.
To be fair, though, it also that was a series that would deal with different characters, different places,
which is what they said.
I mean, how many books have I read on World War One?
You know, right, exactly. So, anyway, the point is, like, Kennedy may have come in and axed the Clone Wars, mm-hmm. and yet the Yoda Chronicles continued on, right? And I think part of that is like, well, you know, some of this is Lego money. You know, Lego is kind of funding this a little bit, maybe.
I'd be fascinated to look at these contracts they sign with these guys.
Yeah, I'm very curious because like,
it's essentially an ad for Lego.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, it's a toy. Like, literally, you're watching the toys play with each other.
Yeah, and you're watching, like, you're watching what the toys can do, and it's like, oh, I wish I had that toy, and
so
I could make that.
Do that?
Yeah. Like, it's weird, right? But that's the whole Lego phenomenon in itself. Like, I mean, the Lego movie itself was kind of, you know, it was an ad for Legos, but also kind of against Legos because it's like, well, go out and buy a Lego set and build this thing. But that's bad because you should just build your own thing and be creative and don't follow the instructions. But follow the instructions. Like, it was, like the Lego movie had this weird like balance of like, follow the instructions because that's good. No, that's bad. Be creative. Don't follow the instructions.
See, I guess I didn't read it like that. How I read it, this is, you know, a Lego movie now.
Yeah.
Which ties in Star Wars.
I mean, it's the same type of humor.
You know, taking a break for just a second with Yoda Chronicles, I mean, I also watched the Lego Marvel Superheroes special.
Yeah.
And it had the exact same effect.
Just as good?
Just as good as Yoda's Chronicle.
I'll definitely have to dive into it.
And also had none of the studio problems.
Yeah.
Like Wolverine, Spider-Man, Captain America, Avengers, they're all together.
Oh.
Yeah. And like and they're like making the same types of like in-jokes and stuff.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
But like what's cool about it is all the Yoda Chronicles, the Marvel movie, the Lego movie, could all be taking place in the Lego movie universe.
Oh, totally.
You know?
I mean, in the Lego movie, Lando and Han and Chewie show up on the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah.
And it could actually fit in with what's going on in the Yoda Chronicles.
Totally.
Right?
Even though in the what's funny is the Yoda Chronicles does a lot of work to make sure it works with the movies.
Yes.
For some reason. Yes. But we'll get right back to that. But to me, the Lego movie actually was more about it doesn't matter if you're type A or type B and you like to follow instructions or you like to be imaginative. It just matters that you don't try and control everything.
Sure.
You don't try to put clue on it all.
Right. Which is what is really what's great about the Yoda Chronicles is it's not trying to stay correct with the canon. It's playing with it loose. Like you have a lot of, like essentially because we have the OT and we have the prequels. Like, there's two time periods, right?
Yes.
And as I'm watching the Yoda Chronicles, like, I know from the outset that it's taking place in the prequel era, mm-hmm. right? And as it moves forward, it kind of creeps into the OT era, right? But there's a lot of things that are going on in this. And for a kid's show, there's a ton of stuff going on here, right?
Oh, yeah.
Right? That I don't think kids are going to really understand. They may get the funny here and there. They're not getting the overall like what's really going on, which makes this such a wonderful show.
Yeah.
Like, but they're although staying very era correct, like there's never a point where like Vader is interacting with, Anakin.
Yeah.
You know, like they're not breaking any major rules.
Oh,
right?
Sure. Like they're not
Right? But the eras are getting blurred, right?
Oh,
because
totally.
You have you have a Luke and Leia on Geonosis.
Yeah.
You know, you have Anakin on Hoth.
Well, see, to me, this stuff I thought was cool because it actually filled in stuff where it's like, oh, thank God, they don't feel like two separate universes.
Oh, yeah. Like, no, it feels like one separate universe, but you never have, like...
Well, no, I mean, like, what I'm saying is, like, it, like, in the movies and stuff, it always feels like there's this whole other set of planets that we never visit in prequels.
Right, right.
And versus the new ones. It's like, it's cool seeing them go to, you know, Naboo or...
But the other thing is, like, it's very self-aware, like... There's a point in all of this where, like, Vader shows up in a scene in an era where he's not yet Vader, right? And George Lucas, as a Lego character, shows up and is like, Darth, you don't belong in this scene.
That's only in the one movie, though, right?
It's in the one movie, right. They don't... It's not a running joke, but it's a joke that's played out at least once.
Yeah.
You know, where it's like, no... You're not in this yet.
That's the pre-Yoda Chronicles.
Yeah, that's the Padawan Menace. Which, should talk about the titles of these episodes or shows.
Yeah.
Because they're all very... It's kind of a mashup of the actual movie titles. Because prior to the Yoda Chronicles, we get the Padawan Menace.
Mm-hmm.
Right? We get... The Empire Strikes Out.
And The Empire Strikes Out is seen as their first real big success.
Yeah, that's that. You can actually view that entire thing on Legos.com for free.
Mm-hmm.
Then we get into the Yoda Chronicles, and that's the first season is a trilogy of episodes.
These naming structures were so hard to follow.
It's a little bit tough. Honestly, enjoy it for what it is, because I've watched most of these episodes at least twice, and I have a hard time following, like, the main through plot, right? Like, like, I'm just like, okay, what era are we in? What's going on?
I didn't get caught up in a lot of that.
Right, you don't get... That's the thing, is you don't have to get caught up in it to enjoy it.
Well, I think they also played a lot looser pre-True Yoda Chronicles. Once you get to the Yoda Chronicles, I feel like it's actually pretty dialed in.
It is. There's definitely a through line that's going through, but... So, there's also a weird naming structure that I'll get into, but Lego Star Wars, the first season, the Yoda Chronicles, the first, there's only three episodes in the season, so these are, you know, not full seasons by any means, but this is a kid show. First episode is called The Phantom Clone.
Mm-hmm.
Second episode is called The Menace of the Sith. The third episode is Attack of the Jedi. So, it's a little bit, you know.
Just a little name mashup.
Yeah.
There.
Yeah, so then the entire show changes name completely because Disney buys it, and the show is run on the Cartoon Network, and there was a little bit of legality going on here that the show is now going to be on Disney or XD, so they need to distance themselves from being called Lego Star Wars because Cartoon Network apparently owns that title. So they had to change it to just Star Wars.
I'm sure they have other Lego properties that have cartoons.
Yeah. So they had to change it to Star Wars, the new Yoda Chronicles.
Nah, classic move.
Yeah.
Classic move.
Right. Which is, it's funny because, like, I mean, Disney is like, they're just taking control. And, like, I think they own everything at this point. But, like Cartoon Network, I don't think can show any of this anymore, but, like, Disney XD can, but I don't know.
It's funny, though, because the rebranding made us think that it was a whole new show meant for little children.
Right.
I wasn't actually aware it was Lego until I started Googling it.
Oh, yeah, right. It doesn't... As much as, like, the Lego movie...
it's just
movie,
a picture of Yoda who doesn't look particularly
exactly.
Lego.
Exactly. Yeah. As much as, like, the Lego movie was very hardcore Lego with, like... Every single set was made out of Legos and could be built from physical Legos. Not everything in any of these Star Wars Lego shows is all Legos. Like, they land on Tatooine. They're clearly on a sand planet. They land on Hoth. It's snow. And it's not snow made out of Legos. It's snow made out of, you know,
yeah, so
digital
this is
snow.
For Star Wars fans, not necessarily blockheads.
Right,
so.
Right. So the second...
And that was a guess. I assume they call themselves blockheads.
Blockheads, sure. So the second season, which ended up being the new Yoda Chronicles, that delves more into the OT characters. We're following Luke and Han and Leia and Chewbacca.
Yes.
We have four episodes there. The Escape from the Jedi Temple, Race for the Holocrons, Raid on Coruscant, and Clash of the Skywalkers. And folks, do not get hung up on canon or continuity here, because there will be a point where Luke battles the Emperor in a lightsaber battle. There's a point where Luke battles Darth Vader in a lightsaber battle.
Which I would put forth handles it better than the Marvel comic did.
Yeah.
I think that this was, when I was watching it, that was my first thought, where I was like, this was one of the earlier ones I watched, actually. And I was like, oh yeah, this makes perfect sense. Like, this actually works better than they just did it in a couple months ago in Marvel.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about that, because the Holocrons, as we know from the EU, now Legends, is a concept that was originated in the EU. As basically the Holocrons are the kind of the library for all information that the Jedi hold near and dear to their hearts.
And this cartoon pulls no punches, pointing out all the Holocron problems. Right away, the thing is, Obi-Wan, did you grab the Holocrons when you left? It's like, what?
Yeah.
Like, I only left with, like my cloak. Like,
yeah.
You saw at the end, like, there are a lot of them. They're so big. What am I going to do?
Right. So.
Because that's a real problem.
Right. Well, back up a step.
Okay.
This show manages to tell the story of, A, what a Holocron is, B, where the Holocrons end up, and C, like the whole plot line of Holocrons that the original Star Wars movies never touch on.
Or the Clone Wars.
Or the Clone Wars.
Anything.
Or Rebels.
Yeah.
Right?
No one touches the Holocron problem.
There's this whole library of information that is stored in the Jedi Temple, and...
Because it's nebulous technology of cubes.
Cubes.
That can do anything.
Yeah.
These cubes can, we've seen in the EU, can hold entire beings' consciousness.
Yeah.
Can.
Yeah. History of the world, everything, video.
Yep.
Audio, and digital.
Basically,
whatever.
The whole deal was that they're like, well, we saved those two twins. They're our big hope for being Jedi. How are they going to learn how to be Jedi if we don't have the Holocrons?
Well, they have Yoda to teach them. Oh, wait, they don't need Yoda to teach them because we have a whole library of Holocrons.
Right.
Right? And that's the genius of the show, is it actually tells the history of the Holocrons and why there are now no Holocrons available for Luke to learn.
But unlike a whiny, shitty fan... Like, they actually earn the no prize, and they make a whole story that explains...
They make a whole story.
That fits within the continuity in between Empire and A New Hope.
Yes.
And, fills in what happened to the Holocrons, where
yes.
they are.
Yes.
A humorous way.
In a humorous way, but,
It actually works.
It tells a story.
Yeah.
It's a well-thought-out story.
Totally.
Right? The other thing that it tells a good story is... I completely lost.
Do we want to summarize kind of what goes down here in these seven?
Oh, okay.
Just
give
the basic through line of.
I have what I was. The Sith clone.
Yes.
We didn't touch on him.
Jack 14.
Jack 14. So basically, the series starts out. The series proper starts out. The Yoda
Phantom
Chronicles.
Clone.
Right. Starts out with basically there's four. Young Padawans that are Yoda's students. They each have lightsabers, and their lightsabers get stolen by General Grievous in a very humorous way. Because General Grievous is like as much as you may have been indifferent, maybe hated General Grievous in the prequels, in this you can't help but love him because he's just ridiculously funny. Like, there's a scene where four kids are on top of General Grievous, fighting him, and he doesn't know what's going on, and it's just hilarious.
All the different Grievous Emperor interactions in this.
Oh, the Grievous, like the miscommunications in this through holograms are genius.
Well, they do such a great job of like pointing out just logistically how difficult it is to be the Chancellor of Republic and the Dark like Sith Lord.
There's a lot of running jokes in this, and one of the biggest ones is basically Palpatine switching identities in mid-sentence most of the time.
Yeah.
When he's talking to Jedi on a hologram and then talking to the Sith on another hologram, and he keeps having to pull his hood over and getting confused as to who he's talking to and who his persona is at any given time.
I love whenever everyone sees him with a hood, everyone goes, oh,
yeah, and everyone's surprised.
And he takes the hood off, like, no, it's all good.
Yeah. So
anyhow,
so anyway, they build a clone.
Yes.
A Sith clone. Yeah. Out of the young Padawan's kyber crystals in their lightsabers. Yep. Grievous steals their lightsabers, gets their kyber crystals, which I don't know will ever come back into canon or not.
Kyber crystals?
Yeah.
I thought those were in Rebels.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah, so they are in canon. Yeah. Okay.
Kyber crystals.
Actually, they're in Clone Wars, too.
Oh, that's right.
Right. So anyway, they put four kyber crystals together to create a one big crystal that can make clones, Sith clones, right? And they make one Sith clone. They're only successful in making one Sith clone, and that is a man by the name of Jek.
Jek 14.
J-E-K 14, because mm-hmm. he's a clone. And he has a glowing arm, and he is all-powerful, and he can zap Yoda, and he can zap...
It's the classic badass, like, the classic badass thing in comics and stuff, where it's like, and he's got a robot arm.
And he has a robot
arm. He's got, like, a kind of glowing bionic-looking arm.
Glowing bionic arm that he kind of can't control, but, you know, he manages to zap everyone with it.
And this, to me, is the point where the storytelling was just this, like, really weirdly fun, like... The end of the Lego movie.
Yeah.
Where you find out all these crazy plot lines have all been because it's all being ran by, like, a silly little boy.
Yeah.
You know? And it's like, oh, that's why it's so funny.
Right.
And, like, if you look at this like that, it kind of has that vibe.
Oh, yeah. Totally.
You know, like, this is totally a storyline I would have come up with my friends. You know, the idea of, like, hey, they take the Kyber crystals and they make a Super Sith clone. You know what I mean?
It does... Yeah, I don't know if I can even express it better than you have, but I had the exact same idea.
Yeah.
It's like, this is a show about guys who played Star Wars with their Legos.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's what,
like,
it is.
It's totally, I think that's why we identified with it so much, is that it was like, this was like what I was doing when I was playing with those toys.
Right.
Like, these were the kinds of storylines that were playing out.
Right.
And, but, like, in the way the continuity matches together, too.
That's the thing.
Very similar.
It's very, like, it all works, even though, like, it's on the verge of not working.
Yeah.
Right? It's on the verge of being like, oh, well, Darth Vader is interacting with Grievous. No, he isn't, because that wouldn't work.
Right.
Like, you think it is, but it doesn't, right? And there's a couple characters in this, Yoda included in this, who... throw off your idea of what era you're in, because you have Yoda in this, who obviously has lived, you know, in both eras, right? Mm-hmm. But Jabba shows up in this, and Jabba is great in all of this.
Oh,
right?
Yeah, totally.
But he shows up in both eras, and it kind of screws you up, and you're like, okay, am I in the OT, or am I in the prequels? Or am I somewhere in between? Because I don't know, right?
Yeah, and you get a great... Well, are we just going to keep going chronologically, huh?
I'm just kind of skipping
going
all
over. Okay, yeah.
Right? Yeah, Vader showing up by mistake.
Han and Chewie go to Hoth before Empire.
Right.
You find out that they were sent there by Leia to scout the location.
Right.
And it's like, well, that works. Like,
that
someone would have to scout the location.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Luke and Leia are in Geonosis.
Yes!
Right?
And that's awesome.
It's awesome.
That's totally awesome.
It's awesome and hilarious.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, this, like, it all starts to fit together in, like, not canon. It's not canon. But it's alternate reality. And it's like, well, it's an alternate reality that makes sense.
Well, as I was watching it, though, didn't you, I don't know, to me at least, I kept wondering, and this might be the big question. I kept wondering, I was like, if they were playing this straight,
yes.
If this was canon,
yes.
If this was live action, or some kind of, you know, a more the Clone Wars-esque
realistic
cartoon,
CGI, sure.
Yeah. And this was purported, like, this is canon, this is how it went down.
Yep.
It wasn't quite as jokey.
Yeah.
Would I embrace it, or would I be like, oh, that's so obvious?
That's a good question.
Because the thing is,
a good question.
A lot of the stuff they do is, like, it's the part of what we're reacting to is how, like, it's just so, like, fun and logical
so
in that
fun.
Way. You know, where it's
right.
Like, I love the Rancor. I wonder what the Rancor looks like on Tatooine
right.
Free. Like, well, there's the Hoth place. Someone had to go look at the Hoth place.
Right.
But at the same time, I mean, I don't know, it works. Like,
yeah. Like, there's a point where, like, Obi-Wan decides he has to go, actually. Ghost Obi-Wan is talking to Yoda by a campfire. Through the Force.
Those interactions are great.
Yeah. Through the Force, they're kind of seeing what Luke is doing. And Luke is, like, basically, immediately after he blows up the Death Star, he is, like, proclaiming that he's a Jedi.
Yeah.
Right? Like, he has no training whatsoever. He's like, I'm a Jedi. I can do this. Right? And Yoda and Obi-Wan are, like, kind of looking through the crystal ball and seeing this. Right? Ghost Obi-Wan. And Yoda is like, you need to go talk to Luke because he's out of control. Like,
yeah.
Right? So Ghost Obi-Wan shows up to Luke on the Falcon. And this is the first time, really, that, like, canon or not, like, that Luke sees Obi-Wan as a ghost.
Yeah.
Right? And the first thing he does is, like, oh my God, it's a ghost.
And pulls his lightsaber.
Pulls his lightsaber out and starts blasting him.
Yeah.
Right? Like,
well, it's a ghost. Yeah.
It's ridiculous, but makes sense. It's funny.
Oh, yeah, and, like, right. Well, and there's all this great stuff, too, of, like, there's all this weird, like, great thematic stuff where it's, like, suddenly takes this dramatic turn. Like, so there's the holocrons, right?
Yes.
And Palpatine has stolen all the holocrons.
Yes.
Because Obi-Wan didn't take them with him, because how could he? Like,
right.
There's too many.
I mean, and, there's, like, thousands of them.
Yeah, and so, basically, Palpatine has just been spending his days watching these holocrons, and then, like, finding out any information you could get from them, and then going and wiping out the people that the information
right.
was on.
Right.
And just having a great time doing it.
Right.
But the thing is, they need to get one of these holocrons because Luke needs to finish his training.
Yes.
And
because they hadn't decided at this point in the not-canon universe they were playing in
mm-hmm.
that Yoda should train him. They're relying on the holocrons to train Luke instead of Yoda training Luke.
Right.
So that's where, like,
well, 'cause you gotta admit,
if you're playing into how this fits in the canon, this is before Obi-Wan and Yoda have decided that Yoda's gonna train.
And if you think about it,
Luke.
That makes sense too. So it's like, I'm not gonna have my 80-year-old father
right.
train my kid.
Well, there's a great, like, and there's also a great point where Qui-Gon as a ghost shows up.
Oh, it's funny.
Right?
So funny.
And he's like, well, yeah, we can't train Luke yet. He's too immature. And Yoda's like, yeah, I agree. He's too immature. And Qui-Gon's like, no, I meant you. You're too immature.
Yeah.
Like, you can't train him. Because Yoda is kind of like, Yoda's a way, he's portrayed as a much looser character in this.
Totally.
Right? He's totally Yoda. He's very all-knowing in that. But he's totally like, you know, like, he's looser. Right?
Oh, sure.
He's looser. He has more of a sense of humor. You know, there's a point where, you know, the clone troopers are calling him bro.
Yeah.
And Mace Windu makes a point of, like, you know, how come we have to call you master and they can call you bro? And
how I roll, that is.
How I roll, that is.
That was one of the great lines initially. But this whole holocron thing, though, so there's, like, so various comings and goings happen.
Yes.
Encounters with Darth Vader.
Yes.
What have you.
Yes.
But ultimately, it comes down to Palpatine is going to... It's a situation where they could destroy all the holocrons.
Yes.
Or Palpatine is going to take possession of them.
Yes.
And Luke pulls a move from one of the Jedi he's been watching in the holocron.
Anakin.
Yeah. Who doesn't know it's Anakin
doesn't
yet.
Know it's his dad.
Yeah, but he's pulling these, like, he likes this Jedi who's really cool and, like, yeah. Does whatever he wants. Yeah. And it's like, I was like, well, they mean more to you anyhow, so then destroy them. And so, yeah, the long story short, the holocrons get destroyed, and then they leave, and it's like, I wish there was one left. And R2 has one inside of him.
R2 has one inside of him.
And he gives it to to Luke, and Luke's like, wow, and he's looking at it, and he's looking at this little square cube, and inside the cube is a video of Anakin training. He's like, I wonder who that Jedi was.
I want to be just like him.
I want to be just like him. And I was like, that's like a great moment.
Yeah.
On two levels.
Yeah.
Like, number one, it's kind of cool that, like, R2-D2 had a holocron inside him.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. Like, he's an exceptional droid, clearly.
Yes.
Maybe he does have a holocron inside him.
He could, sure.
Also, it's just like, that character beat should have existed somewhere.
Right.
You know?
Right.
In the franchise.
Yes.
For Luke to, like, get to see his dad and be like, or, like, know something more about Anakin. Sure. Other than just that brief conversation.
Well, I mean, like, that's where the fun comes in this show is, like, kind of pointing out the foibles that the six films have because of how they were created. Now, obviously, the middle was told before the beginning, so the big problem with the prequels is they're telling the story, trying to match up to where they end up in the, you know, in A New Hope.
Yeah.
And you know, like, that was always a hard task for Lucas to do, but, like, and nothing's perfect in the Star Wars universe. Get over it, folks. Nothing's perfect. So there are mistakes that happen along the way. Enjoy it for what it is. And that's what the beauty of the show is just like, look, enjoy it for what it is. We're going to make fun of, you know, the plot holes here and there, the things that should have been, that could have been.
Yeah.
We're going to point those out. We're going to delve on those things that could have been and should have been. And bring those into the Star Wars universe. Maybe not as canon. Definitely not as canon. But we're going to touch on them, and we know.
Because I think it's also not defining, like, what canon is or isn't. What it is, what it's about is that, like, it's dealing with both children and man-children.
Yes.
In a delicate way where it's, like, showing how fun it is. But, like, I think it's cognizant that there's a line for people who really love this stuff, yeah. Whether you're a child or a child at heart, that, like, well, we can't just pick it apart. Like, they actually had to, they filled in cracks too. You know, they did some of the no prize work to, like,
right.
Well, maybe this is what happened to the holocrons.
Right.
Well, maybe this is.
But the point I was trying to make, and I think why you and I enjoyed this so much is because we love Star Wars, right? Yeah. We both have, you know, we've gone full circle, mm-hmm. Not liking Star Wars, you know, loving Star Wars.
The cheap George Lucas jokes.
Making the cheap George Lucas jokes, being angry at the prequels. We've gone all through this, right? Yep. And the fact of the matter is we've come full circle and we accept it for what it is, mm-hmm. right? It may not be perfect. It may not be, you know, line up, but it's still something we very much enjoy and so much that we talk about it every week, right? And this show, like, acknowledges all of that.
Yes. It
acknowledges all of that. And in a way, as the Clone Wars did, makes the movies better for it.
Yeah. And it acknowledges all of it up to that point.
Yeah.
Like, all six films and the Clone Wars.
Yeah. 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 It points out everything that could and would and should have been better and
has a fun time doing it.
Like, Like, it's just so ridiculously funny. Like, there's a whole episode that, do yourself a favor, folks, track down the episodes before the Yoda Chronicles proper, because there's a whole 23 minute episode of Yoda and a young Han Solo teamed up.
I just watched it. It's hilarious. I would recommend starting with the Yoda Chronicles just because I feel like it's a tight package.
It's a tight package, yeah. It's a seven episodes of basically one storyline.
And Jack does come back in that latter time.
Yeah, so you said you watched some of the shorts where Jack's storyline is wrapped up.
Yeah, because they kind of end, I mean, they end with Clash of the Skywalkers, they end the storyline well. The Jet character's fate is still kind of up in the air.
Yep.
If you go to the Lego, lego.com/Star Wars/movies/Yoda Chronicles, you can find your way there.
Yeah.
They have a couple episodes called Goodbye Jack and A Farewell to an Arm. And okay. Those cover up what happens to Jack and ultimately where he ends up.
Nice.
And
nice.
Yeah, it's good. It's cool because Jack is very much of that Lego character who, you know, can just build and create by using the Force.
Yeah,
you know,
like, and that's a interesting point of this is like in all, because this is Lego, like there is a new Force power,
yeah,
and that is the power to build things with Legos.
Yeah, and that's like, and what's because it's a Lego world. There's a point where he's on indoor building trees.
Yes.
Yeah,
I did see that part.
So
right, but there's also a point where like a clone trooper gets blown apart with a blaster.
Yeah,
and like Yoda is running, and he's like kind of rebuilding things that were exploded, and as he's running, he rebuilds the clone trooper who ends up running alongside him.
Is that Commander Cody?
It might be. Yeah, Commander Cody. Yeah, I think he actually is. Like, always, Rex isn't in it, but Cody is.
I always cross Commander Cody and
Cody's Rex. Yellow. Rex is blue.
Okay,
yeah. Nice. I think it was Cody. Cody has actually some funny lines in that episode, too.
Now, Commander Cody's in the films.
They're both in the films.
Which one's Rex in?
Rex is the blue guy.
Well, yeah, but which movie's that?
They're both in Sith.
Oh.
I believe they're both in Sith.
What the fuck?
Maybe Rex isn't in Sith.
Yeah, one's in Attack of Clones.
Cody is actually called out by name in Sith.
It's so hard to follow those in the prequels. Like, in the Clone Wars itself,
yeah,
much better.
Much easier.
They sure, really
they have personalities.
Yeah.
I believe...
I gotta watch prequels again, man. It's been a while. It's been about a year.
Sith is probably one that I need to watch. Because I believe... I know for a fact that Cody is called out by name.
Hmm.
And Obi-Wan calls... Says Cody. But I don't know if Rex is actually called out. I'll have to watch it.
I think it's called out in the crawl. Maybe?
No.
No?
I don't think any of them are called out in the crawl.
Someone
that
is.
Would be too personal for the movies.
I feel like someone is because it feels very, what's the word? Very like space opera-y.
Oh, both sure. Their names. Serial?
Yeah.
Serial-like?
So, yeah, serial. So anyhow.
Anyhow.
Neither here nor there.
Anyhow.
Might be due for a prequel refresher soon.
That's maybe. Maybe.
So,
little
tease.
Yeah. Folks, track down the Yoda Chronicles. A lot of it is on Lego.com. A lot of it you may have to find a way to download it, whether it's iTunes or any other nefarious source.
Sure, it's all legally up there on YouTube.
Yeah. It's great fun. As much as we originally started Delusions of Granular recommending the Clone Wars, and even more recently, falling down on the positive side of recommending Rebels.
Mm-hmm.
I think this even more so has two solid thumbs up by JP and myself.
Agreed. It's just a lot of
great,
fun.
Just great. I mean, 5 minutes into this, I was watching this with a big silly grin on my face.
Well, and it's also a lower cost of investment. You're not watching five seasons.
It's seven episodes, eight at the most.
And the episodes are like 20 minutes.
Yeah, maybe like 5 hours of your time at the most to watch everything, maybe.
It's a fun diversion, but it's got heart.
Yeah, it's got heart. Honestly, I would say that the effects in this, like the space battles are pretty damn fun.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the lightsaber battles are pretty damn fun. Do yourself a favor, if you can. Find it in HD because the animation in some of these are pretty remarkable.
Mm-hmm.
The textures, the lighting, thumbs up all the way.
Yeah.
Like, thumbs up all the way. Don't think of this as a kid show. Just think of this as a funny Star Wars.
Yeah, I feel a little self-conscious that we just did a Gush show, but you know, the thing is, like, I feel like we had to really, like, endorse this thing.
We did, yeah. I don't know what people's awareness of this is.
Yeah, if you were already aware of this, feel free to write in and be like, guys, I've been watching this for years.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to hear someone give us a story about like that.
Yeah, definitely, because it almost feels like it's something that you and I discovered first.
It's weird. Like, I feel like we had to discover it, like, because we were looking for content.
Yeah.
Like, well, yeah. Here's this other Star Wars thing. Because we weren't, like, excited to do it.
No, not at all. But 5 minutes into it, I was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wonder if the effect would be the same if we'd listen to an hour and a half podcast where guys are just like, this is the best. Like...
Well, I think
it holds up.
I think
I'll put my money where my mouth is.
I would hope to say that 30 some episodes into our podcast that people are kind of looking to what we say.
Yeah,
you know, we are kind of a voice of we are a Star Wars voice out there. Whether you agree with us or not, we're established in being a voice.
Yes,
We find the granular bits of the universe and talk about it.
And we don't hate it.
And bring it on, and bring it to you.
Yes.
All right, folks.
Yes.
So, JP, anything else for the granular universe today?
Yes. No.
No?
No.
No?
Yes.
All right, folks. Yoda Chronicles. Search it out. Find it. And until next week. Yeah, consume it. Tell us what you think of it. Until next week.
I am JP.
I am Ron.
Together we form Delusions of Granular.
Like, all right.
Talking Star Wars.
Talking Star Wars. All right, folks.
Not hearing Star Wars.
Be granular.
Bye. Be granular.